May the Lord bless you. We are continue our course on discipleship, and today we're going to talk about mentoring. Very practical course. By the end of the session, you're going to do some homework and start the process of mentoring. Mentoring is actually another word for discipleship on a one-to-one basis. So the secular world have used mentors, where people mentor one another. It means they speak into their lives, into a very personal and intimate relationship. So the Word of God teaches us, just as a nursing mother cares for her children, we care for you because we love you so much. We are delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. We are encouraging, comforting, and urging you to live lives worthy of God, who calls you into His kingdom of glory. We can see this relationship between Paul and Timothy, where Paul instructed Timothy to entrust the Word of God to other reliable men who are also capable of trusting others. In the life of Jesus, we saw Jesus, there was times when He ministered to a lot of people. He had 12 disciples, and out of the 12 disciples, He had a closer relationship with John, whom wrote the book of Revelation, with Peter, and with James. So even Jesus had relationships with different categories. So mentorship is a very personal one-to-one. So Jesus developed mentoring relationship with His disciples. He was the teacher, the counselor, and guide to all His disciples. He closely mentored that relationship in three key disciples, Peter, James, and John. Mentoring is the key message with the Great Commissions, because we make disciples, not just witness to outsiders. It's an important part of discipleship as we grow and learn to live by faith. So what is the introduction? A mentor is a wise and trusted counselor or teacher. Somebody you can go to for wisdom. We used to say that wise old uncle that stays in the mountain, where you can go and sit and listen and he will give you answers. My whole life I had mentors. In business world, where I do business, I have a guy who is in his 70s, established, well-known person, a man of God, well-known in the church community. And whenever I have to make an important business decision, I ask him for counsel. And he shares his wisdom with me. When I was young, I had mentors to guide me. So my life has been well established in mentoring relationship. First, I had a mentor, and now I have become a mentor and apply that which I have taught to people. So God create us the need of mentor: parents, teachers, bosses, and pastors. So as a pastor, I have another pastor. He's more senior than me. I go to him and ask him for advice in the church. I have another person I go to when I have issues with my wife and children, because I look up to them. So in my life, I've got a business mentor. I've got a mentor to instruct me, give me wisdom with my children. I have another pastor in another church close by who I go to and ask for advice for our church. So it's healthy and it helps us to make wise decisions. So what do we see here? Mentoring is what? One is a commitment to one-to-one discipleship relationship. So it's intimate. It's not only a small group, but it is the person you actually disciple on a one-to-one basis. It's an investment in that person's life. You're going to invest your time, your wisdom, everything you have, and reduplicate that in that person, allowing them to develop their own unique giftedness, but you will invest your time in their life, passing on the faith of Jesus. So it's an apprenticeship where both the people respect and rely on each other. Spiritual reproduction takes place and maintain Christian leadership from one generation to another. So this is really the heart of every one of us, reduplicating us. The person who we will entrust our business to, our ministry to, we passed what we have to that person who will take over from us. 2 Timothy 2 verse 2, I've referred to this verse many times. And the things you've heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable people who are also qualified to teach others. If you die tomorrow, who will be able to take over your ministry? That person is the person you should entrust into a mentor relationship. Principles of mentoring, first of all, is commitment. There has to be commitment from both of you. Talking on the responsibility to develop a one-to-one relationship. Time investment for the ongoing process. You're going to prepare for the meeting. You're going to spend at least an hour a week with this person. So over the next year, you're going to spend at least 50 hours with that person. So it's a lot of time you invest. Pledging to completely follow God's word and God's will. That is the crux. It's not just mentoring your ideas. We are going to build our relationship on the word of God and the will of God. So we're going to search God's will. It's a process. You are going to guide that person. Discern how do they hear the voice of God. Is this really the voice of God they are hearing? And if it is, are they willing to follow it? There's going to be accountable. Openness, not only from them, but also from you. You need to be vulnerable and tell them your struggles. So it's a very intimate, close relationship. And there must be a willingness to repent. That person is going to speak into your life and you're going to speak into their life. Answer to the other person. You have to agree. That person is going to ask you questions. Some of that question is going to be very difficult. So you need to agree to that. Confidential. So if you mentor a person, you don't tell your wife what you've discussed, or tell your friends, or tell your other, if you two or three said, oh, I talked to this guy to know, and he really struggled with this. You pray for that. No. If a person tells you something, you keep it to yourself. The only other person you can talk to about that point is to the Lord quietly. Not praying loudly that other people can hear. They trust you. Don't break that trust. Mutually agree on some information to build up the body of Christ. So don't share what they've confidentially discussed with you, with anyone, without their giving you the permission. Voluntary. So the person is willingly to enter that relationship. It's not forcefully. They're willing. They agree to that. Offering up time needed for the long-term commitment. Allow it to end as either person may request or need it. So that person mustn't become dependent upon you. Agree for the next 3 years or the next year, I'm going to have a mentor relationship with you. We're going to search God's will, and then that relationship as mentor end. You can still be friends, but that relationship between mentoring needs to have an end. It cannot last forever. Then it's not mentoring. So when that person becomes a mentor to other people, you can still meet with them on a monthly basis or as friends, but that mentoring relationship have a start and it has a finish. What is the characteristics? 1-to-1. It's not 1-to-2. It's 1-to-1. Same gender only. Be very careful. Don't mentor females. Females don't mentor men. Youth can mentor one another, but always same gender. Don't allow the devil to tempt you, because you are going to become intimately involved in that person. So keep it male to male, female to female. Maybe somebody you know or somebody you don't know. Enter in the relationship. A third person may help with a match. So if you're the pastor and there's 5 people you've mentored through the years, next year they are going to mentor other people. So you may help them choose people who wants to enter into this relationship. Maximum of perhaps 3 to mentor at a time. So that is more challenging. I would prefer to doing 1-on-1 or 1-to-2, but 1-to-1 is most effective. Bible is the main tool. Stick to that. Commit to that. We're going to study. Search God's will on this relationship. It happened in answer to God's call. So God calls us to walk together. So how to mentor? How to get started? Some practical ideas. After prayer and discernment of God's guidance, select the person to mentor. So let God lead you. He knows your talents and he knows your gifting and he knows who needs that which he has put into your hands to whom you need to entrust that. Have an exploratory meeting where you agreed upon establishing the mentoring. So you meet together, said, listen, we're going to have this relationship for the year. We're going to meet every week. This time, from this time to this time. So we keep one another accountable. It could end here, as it needs to be mutually. Also God's will. So pray, does God want you to give your time to that person? If he does, then you agree to that. If the person is lost, you first need to bring him to Christ. So sometimes people outside the church, they really need, they look up to you, they ask, can you mentor me? Even if they're unbeliever. Where you start, say, yes, I can, but let me first tell you what we do. We believe in Jesus Christ. He has the power to transform your life. Is God in your life? Have you accepted him? If you haven't accepted him, you are not able to receive the power of the Holy Spirit to transform you. So I can give you all the wisdom in the life, but I cannot change it. The Holy Spirit can. And then you lead him to Christ if they are willing to enter into that relationship. Otherwise, you just decide. You need to evangelize them first before you can mentor them. Determine the mentoring process. When and where to meet. Agree on the Bible as the guidebook. We are not going to study books together or share nice ideas. No, we're going to study the Word of God. So the second meeting, what life issue topics, what are we going to discuss? How are we going to work through that? Plan each session and schedule and topics. Meet regularly on a weekly basis or at least every second week. So remain flexible. If there's some other meetings we need to change, we can change, but we have to commit. Good principle is if I have something that happened that I cannot attend, it's my obligation to change the meeting to a time that both of us can meet together within the same week. Have a brief encounter and catch up. So when you start up, when you meet together, last time we talked about this and this, how did you apply? Do you see progress? Is there growth in your life? Use notes taken at first. So you start with childhood, young adulthood, understand who the person is, where they grow up, were both of their parents alive, what was the role of the father, what was the role of the mother, do they have any dramatic issues that impacted their lives, what was the choices they've made. So find out who the person is in the first few sessions and then you work through the things. Review, discuss notes, discover needs and make mentoring goals. What is the end of our relationship? Beautiful scripture, encouraging spiritual growth, but as for you, continue in what you've learned and have become convinced of, because you know those whom you learned it and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through the faith in Jesus Christ. Isn't this beautiful? You know whom you have learned from. You have convinced from infancy and have known the Holy Scriptures. It is we mentor people through the Holy Spirit, through the Holy Scriptures, allowing them to grow in faith. Goals are covered. The goals should be research in the Scripture for guidance. We want to read this. What does the Scripture say about this? Pray together. So every session you end with prayer, praying with one another, allowing to listen to the Holy Spirit. What is he saying? Part of the process of mentoring is allowing that person to really know the voice of the Holy Spirit and obey the voice of the Holy Spirit. Give them homework. You, as the mentoring person, you know the scripture. Said, oh, but you know, have you read the scripture? Next time, before we meet, please read Romans chapter 8 or please read Psalm 91. And then next time we discuss what does the scripture say about this issue. So always refer them back to scripture and start, how did that scripture apply to your life? And then you will be amazed to see how the Holy Spirit and the scriptures work together to bring change in that person. Be testimonial, share spiritual growth with others. Witness to the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. So it's beautiful to see people growing in faith, growing in Christ, growing in knowledge of scripture, applying that knowledge in their lives and seeing the Holy Spirit working in their lives. Then when to end that relationship, when God leads you to end it, you see that person is now mature, they've worked through the issues, and you said, oh, wonderful, in 2 or 3 months' time, I'm going to release you, and then you are going to apply that which I have taught you through this process in the lives of others. When he's capable of mentoring other people. When life situation change your mode, or you're not able to meet together anymore. So, every Christian should have a mentor and be a mentor for all their lives. That's the principle. Paul said to Timothy, Timothy, my son, I'm giving you this command in keeping with the prophecies once made about you, so that by recalling them, you may fight the battle well, holding on to the faith and the good conscience, which some have rejected and have suffered shipwreck with regards to their faith. Paul was mentoring Timothy up to the end. So my friends, in conclusion of this lesson, let's look at page 67. Who do I feel led by the Lord to mentor? Pray about that. Second one, who are some people who are spiritually ready to be mentors in your church? Identify them. Who is in need of mentoring in your church? And who might be the matches? So, in your churches, grow through this, so then you start the discipleship program. Start the process of getting people to mentor other people. May the Lord bless you.